Hello, our viewers at Gaddis Rabaduri program on the OMN. Welcome. The Oromia Support Group organized a conference in London on the 8th and 9th of July. This is a follow-up discussion about that conference. To discuss about this and more is Dr. Trevor Truman. Welcome to the show, Dr. Trevor.
Good evening, Ober Garma. Thank you for having me.
Thank you again. Thank you for coming on the show again. Let's start our discussion with the proceedings of the conference. How was the conference? Was it a success? You guys did discuss on that conference? Let's start our discussion with that.
Okay. And it was a great success as far as I was concerned. I was very happy with the outcome. I perhaps was expecting a few more people, but the three or four dozen people that came were a really good mixture of expertise from all over the world. It was wonderful. Mm-hmm. And the whole idea of the conference wasn't to do the usual preaching to the choir, but to try and get new ideas and new ways of working, and to try and get out of the doldrums that the diaspora seem to be in at the moment in terms of effective information gathering, information sharing, and campaigning. And we divided into working groups, as we said we would. These weren't quite as we originally planned. We had to adapt to circumstances in terms of how much of an issue was there to be debated. So we altered the sizes of some working groups and we amalgamated others. But it meant that we ended the weekend with a definite plan of action for OSG in different countries, mm-hmm. and a way forward over the next few months and years. Overall messages from the conference, there was great consensus for cooperating with other organizations and groups and to be inclusive in our outlook and to try and resist any divisive tactics that are thrown up usually at the behest of the Ethiopian government, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. And we decided on definitive courses of action. We are supporting the Oromo Advocacy Alliance call for interaction with congressmen and senators in their resolutions supporting the respect for human rights and encouraging inclusive governance in Ethiopia. At the House of Representatives, it's Resolution 128, mm-hmm. and at the Senate, it's Resolution 168, same wording. And we really would encourage people in America to go and contact their representatives, congressmen and senators, to support those resolutions, but also as a way of using this as an opportunity to inform them about the situation in Ethiopia and where their tax dollars are going, what sort of regime they are supporting over there. And the other and probably most important outcome of the conference was to stimulate campaigning and commemoration of the Arecha massacre last year so that we never forget that awful atrocity. And Arecha should be celebrated as the beautiful thing that it is, and there's no doubt about that. But we should also add to the whole process some commemoration for those who died so that their sacrifice will not have been in vain. Mm. And, well, we owe it to them, and I think we owe it to the Oromo community worldwide to not accept that sort of atrocity with the sort of silence with which it's been met by the international media. We should hammer it home again and again and use the anniversary of the atrocity as an occasion to do that.
We will come to that possibly in the latter part of our show, Dr. Trevor. You were saying that you had working groups, and you also mentioned about this resolution 168. It passed yesterday, right? This has been on the media.
I'm out of the loop. I didn't hear that. I'm sorry.
Yeah, absolutely. I would really like you to highlight on this. It was voted out unanimously yesterday in the U.S. So what's the next step? It has already passed the first one. And what should people do after this? And how this is going to impact, actually, the state of affairs in Ethiopia generally?
Well, it depends how much leverage we use it. Mm-hmm. And now it's up to us to really campaign using that resolution. That is fantastic news. And congratulations to the Oromo Advocacy Alliance in the USA for pushing that through. That's Bonnie and her followers, and also Sena. Oh, excellent news. Very, very good. I'm delighted to hear that. But now we've got to ram it home, haven't we? Mm-hmm. It's, the Ethiopian government spends billions of dollars every year paying often ex-politicians and ex-diplomats to do lobbying on their behalf in the US. And so they'll be working very hard to counter the effect of that resolution. Mm-hmm. So we must redouble efforts to use that resolution as a reason to going to speak personally to your representatives, congressmen and senators, and give them your stories. It's personal stories that really persuade people what's happening. So tell them your stories and ask them what their government is going to do in terms of its support for that regime. Oh, that's, you made my day, that's great.
Yeah, that's absolutely great. Thank you again. Also about this working group that you briefly mentioned earlier that you established during the conference, I would like really you to talk about these different working groups and what are these working groups and what they do.
We didn't establish working groups for anything longer than the conference. Mm-hmm. We already have a steering committee of the Oromia Support Group, mm-hmm. with members based mainly in the UK, and in various parts of Australia. Mm-hmm. However, during the conference, we divided into groups of people so that everybody could air their opinion, and there was a time for all serious opinions to be noted and considered. And so everyone had a say in the policy of what the Oromia Support Group is going to be doing over the next few months and years.
All right. Now, from these proceedings, in fact, you also mentioned that it was not a kind of preaching to the choir, but presumably you had some presentations, even though you were concentrating on the actions. But I would like you to briefly take us through some of the points that actually were talked in addition of the actions and action plans and all these working groups. Yes, briefly.
We limited presentations, mm-hmm. in a bit cruel way. I was chairing a lot of the proceedings at the plenary part, and I was brutal in terms of limiting presentations to very short, because we wanted the valuable time of the weekend to share ideas and plans and to make plans, not to just tell people everything that they already knew in terms of the occurrence of abuses and this sort of thing. Notable presentations, well, all of them were very good. Marama made a very good case for celebrating the Arecha massacre, mm-hmm. and the student killings. Awol made a very good case and informed us about legal challenges that can be made to the Ethiopian government. And these are all areas where we're going to be working on. Bonnie made some lovely comments over the over Skype, and one of the most impressive contributors was Felix Horn from the Human Rights Watch. He's the researcher for Ethiopia and Eritrea, and he was pointing out that there is a lack of information, there is an information gap in terms of atrocities committed in the Oromia region. Since the Amnesty report of October 2014, we've had very little information coming out that's usable in a, you know, a report sort of sense, good corroborated, reliable information and detailed so that we can use it in publication. So obviously these are areas that were also explored during during the conference.
Thank you, Dr. Trevor. Let's come to the second part of our discussion. That's about the future plan. You also really briefly mentioned that you are going to commemorate the Eritrea massacre of the 2016 in Bishoftu, and there is this legitimate concern among the public that the Eritrea massacre has not been brought well to the attention or to the spotlight of the international media. And what are you planning to do to address this complaint that Eritrea massacre, as compared to, for example, the Marikana killings in South Africa, it had good publicity, it had good media coverage. The Eritrea massacre, even though many people died as compared to the Marikana in South Africa, it has not been brought to the spotlight of the international media. And I would like you to comment on this and how your plan is going to act towards this.
You're absolutely right, and these were issues that were brought up at the conference. The massacre was of far greater significance than many that reached the attention of the international media, such as Bloody Sunday in Northern Ireland, such as the Sharpeville massacre in South Africa, in which far fewer people were killed and in less dramatic circumstances. Yes, and the reason for this, as we all know, well, twofold, is the billions of dollars that Ethiopia spends on its lobbying apparatus, especially in the USA, Europe, and the UK. And it is due to our failure, really, as people in the diaspora, to make our government, our host government, sit up and take note. So this is what the conference was all about, really, a call to effective action to reverse that process. And so already we have plans underway to have poetry and songs from well-known artists contributing to the commemoration of the Eritrea massacre. And we're encouraging all communities across the globe to celebrate Eritrea, but to use it also as an occasion for contacting organizations local to them, as well as national organizations. Most people change their opinions on local issues or through local media, like local newspapers. And it's at that level that we want Aroma in the diaspora to be active now. And reaching out to members of your church groups, mosque groups, other non-governmental organizations, local amnesty groups, and talking about Aroma issues in those venues and using the Eritrea massacre as a way of informing people about what's going on. And we mustn't forget the student deaths as well, which we'll be calling for more commemoration of that, the following month in November.
Oh, okay.
Don't look to us to organize things for you. You're the one saying, yeah, okay, this is what we should be doing, but we can't organize events across the globe. They have to be, all we can do is suggesting.
Absolutely, yeah. So am I understanding you right if I say that, for example, the Romo diaspora in different parts of the world, they celebrate Irecha, so they are you saying that they have to dedicate their the Irecha day that they celebrate to commemorate these people who were massacred in Irecha last year in Bishoftu?
No, I'm not saying quite that, because mm-hmm. one would never want to detract from the beauty and the pure positive things behind the Irecha ceremony. Mm-hmm. And the thanksgiving and the commonality of all living things and natural things. And it would be a shame to sully that. But as well as that celebration, there should be a commemorative aspect, whether it's on the same day or not, I don't know. But there should be a commemoration so that people are informed about what happened in October 2016, and it is never forgotten. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. But,
for example, a lot of the Irecha ceremony is very attractive to people from different cultures.
Mm-hmm.
So perhaps you would organize an event where local dignitaries, local organizations, media, press, were invited to attend an Irecha ceremony, following which there would be a press conference, perhaps,
mm-hmm.
and this sort of idea.
Yeah, I also agree with you that, in a way, the best way to go about it is to use the Irecha ceremony itself and invite the press and try to bring the issue to the attention to local media. In fact, for example, in different parts of the world, what they do is first they will have the Irecha celebration in the parks or around the lakes, and then during that day night there would be a social event that mm-hmm. that would be organized usually. So I believe that it could be organized as part of that itself, instead of like arranging another day or like that.
Yes, I'm not going to dictate any of ideas that we have.
We just you just recommend.
it is up to local groups to act local, but think global, as they say.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But if you were like to, if you were like asked to recommend, what do you have as a recommendation to go about it?
In addition to what I've said, no, I think I've exhausted my little barrel of ideas in terms of how to advertise local Irecha ceremonies and who to invite to attend them and who to try and explain the situation to. As I say, local dignitaries. In the UK, there would be councillors, people at the local administrative level, as well as members of parliament, congressmen, this sort of thing. People who run local radio stations, local newspapers, as I say, our local press is read by more people than national press in the UK. I don't know what it's like in the USA. But all these media contacts, but it should be a general thing. Oromo communities overall tend to be too inward-looking rather than outward to other communities and other peoples. And this is something that we really need to reverse to try and change public opinion about Ethiopia. And this is why incidents like the Irecha massacre are so important not to forget and to use as a way of communicating with people what's going on in Ethiopia.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Treber. Perhaps before we wind up our discussion, any other plan that you would like to bring to the attention of the public that came out of the conference?
I'm sure Tashelle is going to tell me off afterwards if there's something I've forgotten, but I think those are the main things. We're going to be aiming our efforts at collating information about the massacre and the student killings over the next 2 weeks especially. We would want people in the diaspora, if they have contacts who are eyewitnesses or have spoken to people who are eyewitnesses or people who are eyewitnesses to the things themselves, to contact OSG in Australia.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Trevor Truman, again for coming on the OMN and talking to us about the proceedings of the conference. Thank you, our viewers, too, for watching us. That's all the time we have for today. For me, Girma Gutsema, and our digital producer, Farhan Abdersalam, thank you again for watching, and goodbye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.